Penguin Random House Audio presents An American Summer, Love and Death in Chicago. This is the author, Alex Kotlowitz. For Maria. An American Summer, Love and Death in Chicago. Prelude to a Summer. Near midnight on August 19th, 1998, the phone rang, an unusual occurrence at my parents' home in upstate New York, where I was visiting with my wife and infant daughter. I got out of bed and scrambled to the hallway to grab the phone. The voice on the other end sounded familiar, but I couldn't quite place it. "It's Ann Chambers," she said. Ann was a Chicago violent crimes detective whom I knew. She told me she was calling from the kitchen in our home in Oak Park, a suburb bordering Chicago. She told me that Farrow was there with her, and that he may have been involved in a murder. My legs buckled. I sat down to catch my breath. This was the Farrow from my book, There Are No Children Here, a boy who stepped cautiously, who loved school, and who was so charming and vulnerable that adults went out of their way to protect him. Shortly after the book came out, Farrow, who had grown up in one of the city's housing projects, had moved in with me for what I thought would be a short period. I'd helped him get into Providence St. Mel, a college prep school on the city's west side, and he was struggling, understandably. He couldn't find quiet in his first-floor public housing apartment as rivers of people flowed in and out daily, mostly family and family friends. He called and told me he just wanted to catch up with his schoolwork. "Could I stay with you just for a while?" he asked. "Maybe a week or two?" I was single at the time, unencumbered and with a spare bedroom, so I invited him to stay. Though only 12, he knew what he needed. He brought with him a garbage bag filled with clothes and his school backpack. Those 2 weeks turned into 6 years. When I got married, Farrow walked my wife, Maria, down the aisle, along with her dad. We moved to Oak Park as we wanted to be near his school, and we figured it was a community that wouldn't look askance at this unusual arrangement. His adolescent years were rocky. I didn't anticipate how this living situation would pull at his sense of identity. While his mother, LaJo, supported his decision to live with Maria and me, others in his family didn't. One time, his mother called and, after leaving a message, forgot to hang up. And so on my answering machine, I listened to a 5-minute rant by a friend of their family berating LaJo for letting Farrow live with a white couple. "He don't belong there," the woman told LaJo. "He ain't white." I knew it had to be hard for Farrow. He undoubtedly heard these harangues as well. It's tough enough to be a teen in the best of circumstances, grappling with who you are and who you want to be. And here Farrow had to figure out who he was while living with two white adults who were not related to him by blood, who were not his parents, who were not even his legal guardians. In particular, he had an older brother, I gave him the pseudonym Terrence in the book, who clearly resented Farrow's decision to live with us. And so he would try to pull Farrow into his activities in the street. There was also a measure of opportunism here, as he knew that Farrow, who had never been in trouble with the law, would not likely draw the attention of the police. It felt like a tug of war, and I often felt on the losing end. At one point, Farrow knew he had to get away, to find some reprieve from these forces pulling at him, and so at his request, we sent him to a boarding school in Indiana, a military academy where he had attended summer camp. A week after he left, I was tidying up his bedroom, picking clothes off the floor, making his bed, and finally cleaning his closet, where on the top shelf I noticed a worn black leather bag the size of a medicine ball. I reached to pull it down. It was bloated with cash. I mean lots of cash. Tens, twenties, hundreds, all of it stuffed into the bag without much concern for appearance or organization. I knew right away that it belonged to Terrence, that he probably asked Farrow to hold it for him. I called a friend, an attorney, for advice. His words were simple: "Get rid of it." He called me back a few minutes later and clarified, "I don't mean throw it away." So I called Terrence and told him I had something of his, which he needed to retrieve. He refused to come to Oak Park, worried that I'd set him up with the local police. So I agreed to meet him on the city's west side, and there, in the middle of a one-way residential street in the early afternoon, in the open so that we both felt protected, I handed over to him what turned out to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $18,000. Terrence later accused me of taking $300 from the bag, but that's another story. This is what Farrow was up against, and what we were up against as well. Farrow got kicked out of the boarding school for selling marijuana and eventually graduated from our local public school. He was accepted at Southern Illinois University and had decided not to visit New York with us during this summer trip because he wanted to get ready for school. Classes began the following week, and then I got this call. I knew the detective Ann Chambers from my time reporting There Are No Children Here. Ann, whom everyone in the neighborhood called Mary for reasons I never could discern, had been a member of the plainclothes tactical unit in the neighborhood and had a reputation as a fair-minded officer. She was tough, but cared deeply about the kids. She was a single mother, and we used to talk about her son, who at the time was headed off to Harvard with ambitions to be a police officer. She pleaded with him to do something different. Here's what she told me in that short midnight phone call. Farrow had taken a taxi from our house to his mother's home on the west side, and when the cab pulled up, two young men pulled Farrow out of the back seat and then jumped in. One of them held a pistol to the cabbie's head, demanding his money. The cabbie must have panicked, and when he pressed down on the accelerator, one of the assailants shot him in the back. Ann told me that some detectives suspected Farrow might have set up the driver. Fortunately, Ann knew Farrow from her time in the projects and knew that he wasn't that type of kid. I told her that I, too, couldn't fathom Farrow pulling such a stunt, though privately I worried that maybe his brother had put him up to it. By the next morning, Ann and her colleagues had determined that, in fact, Farrow knew nothing of the robbery. Farrow's sister had seen much of what transpired and could identify the assailants. For my part, I tried to reach Farrow. This was before cell phones. His mother said he was out, but she wasn't sure where. I tried calling regularly throughout the day. Both Maria and I were concerned. He'd just seen someone murdered. It wasn't the first time, I knew, but I also imagined how disorienting it must be. Morning came and went, as did the afternoon. Finally, that evening, I reached him at our house. "Where have you been?" I asked. "Shopping." "Shopping? At Marshall Fields, for school." "Shopping?" I was incredulous. "Yeah." "Farrow, how are you doing?" "Okay, why?" "Why? You just saw someone murdered." "I'm okay. I gotta go. I need to get packed for school." I hung up, shaking my head. I was dumbfounded and angry. How could he not be grieving? How could he not be upset? Shopping? I told my wife that if it was me, I'd be curled up on our couch in a fetal position. I thought to myself, something must be terribly wrong with Farrow. How can you not feel? How can you not cry? How can you not express gratitude for not getting killed yourself? Farrow gets yanked out of the back seat of a taxi by two men with a pistol, and then watches as they shoot and kill someone he's just shared time with. Something I thought was off, out of kilter, and for the longest time, I thought Farrow was without heart, that he'd become hardened if not numb to the violence around him. This, of course, is the mistake we all make, thinking that somehow one can get accustomed to it. I feel like I've been working my way to this book for a long while. In reporting There Are No Children Here, it was the violence that most unmoored me. Since the publication of the book in 1991, four of the kids I befriended have been murdered, including Farrow's nephew, whom even at the age of 21, everyone called Snugs, short for Snuggles. He was killed in retaliation for someone else getting shot. He was the last person murdered before the Henry Horner Homes, a public housing complex, was razed. Another young man, Jojo Meeks, had joined me, along with Farrow and his brother Lafayette, on a fishing trip one summer. He had a smile so wide, you felt like you could just walk right in. Jojo became a stick-up artist, of drug dealers mostly, and was killed when he tried to rob some drug dealers with a BB gun. They were better armed. The numbers are staggering. In Chicago, in the 20 years between 1990 and 2010, 14,033 people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.